Good morning, Christ the King. Welcome to worship. Just a brief preface to our time this morning. Both Lisa Cooper, our music director, and myself are not going to be with you for the rest of the service today. We are taking some time away, so I just wanted to express our thanks for that. We've been putting in some extra hours since all of this have begun, and it's really good to be able to step away and take a breath. So we're grateful for that. We're also grateful to our colleagues in the New England Synod who have provided this service for us today so that we can gather in worship, in prayer, in song, in word, together as Christ's fuller body. So we give thanks for the leadership who have put this together for us today. If you have any questions, you want to know what's going on, always check our website, check our Facebook, check the e-news, or call or email either Tammy or I, and we can get you the information that you need. Blessings on this day of worship and on the week to come. We'll see you soon. Bye-bye.
Welcome. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. My name is Andrew Heisen, and I'd like to thank you for joining us for this worship service as we remember the ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ. What you are about to see and hear is a worshipful collage of sorts. Folks from across our New England Synod have contributed to this worship service. Several, like myself, are from campus ministries. Others work in other specialized ministries, like our preachers today, the Reverends Bill Barter and Angelica Zollfrein. We have here offerings from an ELCA deacon, some people from outdoor ministries, and just regular folks from around the Synod, too. It's a strange time, and it's a challenge for most of us to feel connected to one another. Pre-recorded worship can be tricky that way, too, but I hope that as you watch and listen and participate, along with people from across the Synod who are doing the same thing, that you'll receive this worshipful collage in the same spirit in which it was created, that of people coming together and offering their words and talents so that in sharing our worship of Jesus Christ, we can also be there for each other. To get things started, let's hear and maybe sing along with a hymn of praise, courtesy of someone you might know from Camp Calumet, and someone that I'm proud to call a friend, Knut Ogren.
Almighty God, Your blessed Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, ascended far above all heavens that he might fill all things. Mercifully give us faith to trust that as he promised, he abides with us on earth to the end of time, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the beginning of the book, The Acts of the Apostles. In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. "This," he said, "is what you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." So, when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" He replied, "It is not for you to know the times of periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going and they were gazing up towards heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up towards heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." The word of the Lord.
A reading from Psalm 47. Clap your hands, all you peoples. Shout to God with a joyful sound. For the Lord Most High is to be feared, a great king over all the earth. God has gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sound of the ram's horn. Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises to our King, sing praises. For God is King over all the earth. Sing praises with a song. God reigns over the nations. God is enthroned on high. The nobles of the peoples have gathered as the people of the God of Abraham. The rulers of the earth belong to God, who is highly exalted.
A reading from the letter to the Ephesians, chapter 1. I've heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, and for this reason I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know God, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which you have been called, what are the riches of God's glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of God's power for us who believe, according to the working of God's great might. God put this power to work when Christ was raised from the dead and seated at God's right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And God has put all things under Christ's feet, and has made Christ the head over all things for the church, which is Christ's body, the fullness of the one who fills all in all. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 24th chapter. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with the power from on high." Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they were continually in the temple blessing God. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Bill? Bill, we're on. Bill?
Okay, I'm sorry, Angelica. I was outside, I was outside looking at the sky, and I lost track of the time.
You were looking at the sky?
I was looking at the sky. Well, wait, I'll show it to you. Hold on a second.
Okay.
I'll bring you out and show you the sky.
Oh, wow, it's beautiful. Oh my gosh, it's totally blue sky. Not a cloud in the sky. Amazing. I can see why you would be looking at the sky.
What's that?
I can see why you would be looking at the sky.
Oh, it's beautiful today. It's a beautiful blue. There are hardly any clouds, just a few. And I really enjoy looking at the sky. There was a time in my life when I didn't really think much about the sky that might seem kind of funny, but I lived in Portland, Maine, which is on the ocean, the rocky coast, and the ocean always draws a lot of people, and at least it drew me, and I didn't think much about the sky. But then as a young deacon, a transitional deacon in the Catholic Church, I got sent up to Presque Isle, which is way up in the northern part of Maine, potato farming community. And in Presque Isle, there aren't tall buildings. Instead, there are expanses and expanses of fields. It's just field as far as the eye can see. And because of that, the sky is very prominent. In fact, there's no ocean near Presque Isle. And so the sky, you know, kind of became my ocean for the time that I was there. And so at that young age of whatever I was, 26, I guess, I really started developing an appreciation for the sky.
An appreciation for the sky. That's amazing. You know, one of my earliest memories of the sky is lying on the back in the grass in my family's garden. And my mother was next to me and my grandmother was next to her. And we looked up to the sky and it was this windy day and the clouds were going by. And of course we were constantly imagining what the clouds, you know, what they looked like a bear. Oh no, it's not a bear, it's a horse. Oh no, it's not a horse, it's an old grandma in a chair. You know, so this is how this went on and on and on. And it was just a wonderful afternoon. It must have been this time of the year. I loved it. It was just a wonderful time of looking in the sky.
Yeah, yeah. Well, speaking of sky, this is the Ascension time, and so we're talking about the Ascension, and so in researching or beginning to do the research for this Zoom sermon, I was reminded of a quote by Karl Barth, who refers to the Ascension as a thin line, is the term he uses, a thin line in the history of Christianity, basically, or a thin line of history at all, and yet unrivaled in its significance in the history of the church. So, you know, not very long, not very big in history, except that it's unrivaled in its significance. And I think, you know, that refers to it the Ascension being a turning point after which Christianity really is never the same again.
That makes sense to me. I mean, before the Ascension, the Gospels describe the disciples as being afraid and confused. And yeah, here and there, there are some accounts of sporadic appearances of the risen Christ. And yet, the disciples had no full understanding of what those appearances meant. And they were really actually running away in fear. That's at least how one gospel ends, right? And today's reading alludes to, you know, Jesus meeting them, but it's also part of the history, like Mount Olive was the place where Jesus was captured. And it seems like the story ends with the upper room again, where the disciples gathered earlier with Jesus for the Last Supper. So there are all these memories in the text as well. And then what gets me about this text is the question about the future. Yeah. You know, like the disciples are asking, are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel?
Yeah. You know, in the Creed, we say that on the third day, he rose again and ascended into heaven. And that would make our belief that the resurrection and ascension are part of the same event. You know, Pentecost is around the corner. It happens right after we celebrate the ascension. So once Christ is ascended, the substance of Christianity, who we are, begins to take shape and I think move forward. It has to do a lot with the substance of Christianity, what happens during these times. And I also think that in today's story, one of the key characters is actually the sky.
What? The sky, a key character? I mean, I can see the apostles and the disciples and Jesus and even the two people dressed in white, but the sky, a character in the story?
Well, here's a story for you, a real story that's very touching, I think. I recently saw something on the news that involved the Navy Blue Angels and the Air Force Thunderbirds and medical workers in New York City. When I was growing up, my dad was in the Defense Department, and we lived next to a Navy base. I saw the Blue Angels all the time, but I rarely ever knew of the Blue Angels and the Thunderbirds to fly together. Usually they compete, but it's very rare that they fly in formation together. But in the midst of this pandemic in New York City, they did just that. They joined in a big formation. They flew over the city as a salute to healthcare workers. And the news footage that I saw showed a group of hospital workers, doctors, nurses, cleaning people, technicians, you know, anyone you can think of that works in a hospital. And they were looking up at the sky, waving and applauding as the Blue Angels and Thunderbirds went overhead. It was a happy moment for them. They were likely exhausted from what we know about what's happening in New York. But they were thrilled at this temporary break in the work and to see the smiles on their faces and the show of gratitude from a very grateful nation was really touching. It was striking, but actually what happened after the flyover, we know what happened after the flyover. So after the flyover, all of those maintenance workers, janitors, doctors, nurses, and so forth, all of them went back to work. They turned around and went back into that building.
Right.
They had little time to continue staring at the sky. And I thought, oh my gosh, Bill, this is good sermon material. I still think that way, even though I'm semi-retired. But they turned around and went back to work. And I thought of that, you know, like in the Acts, the apostles, the angel asks, the angels ask, why do you stand there looking into the sky? There had just been this amazing spectacle, the ascension. The risen Christ ascends into heaven, and it must have been something to behold. But the church had little time to be staring up in the sky. Because the work of building up the reign of God that began in that moment happens in the world and not in the sky.
You mean ascension is really saying to us, don't just stand there, do something.
Yeah, exactly. The ascension does not call us to be pie in the sky Christians who put off the reign of God for some later time. You know, pie in the sky thinking focuses on how much better off everyone is in heaven while people on earth could still be suffering. The disciples went back to work. Then they get supercharged by the Holy Spirit of Pentecost. And just like those healthcare workers whose moment of staring at the sky was limited, the disciples really didn't know it was ahead, but they moved ahead anyway. They had little time to stare at the sky. So is the ascension a pie in the sky moment? Or is this a moment when the church takes shape and begins to move forward? Are we a church of the sky or a church of the reign of God here and now? Which one is it that changes the world for the better?
Well, what if it's both? I mean, just like Jesus Christ is both, right? On earth and in heaven. Look, I mean, the risen Christ didn't just disappear and vanish into the clouds, leaving us to do the work as if we're alone and, you know, anxious in an unredeemed world. No. I mean, Christ ascending into heaven meant that dust, human dust, sits at the right hand of the Father. Think about that. I mean, to me, that's just amazing. So it's Christ doesn't lose his humanity through the ascension. And therefore, there's a human being, dust, sitting next to God. And that, in exchange, makes us divine in some sense. And, you know, from where Christ sits now at the right hand of the Father, as we say in the Creed, he continues to love all creation and he shares our every human moment. And he's seated at the right hand of the Father and the earth is his footstool. It's amazing.
Yeah. It's so incredibly incarnational, to put it that way. I don't know if I ever heard that expression exactly, of human dust comes and sits at the right hand of God. That image of that sort of two-way incarnational relationship we have with God. And the ascension is incarnational. It's part of that, you know, that God would dwell not with us, but as us is pretty remarkable.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. So what now? So the work of building the reign happens here on earth. Are we there yet? Or let's get back to work.
I know. I can feel antsy and anxious and itching to get there as well. And, you know, I love how Jesus' friends ask, is this the time to restore the kingdom to God's people, right? And of course, in our days of the COVID crisis, what we ask is this over yet? You know, can we reopen the city? Are the kids going to be able to go to summer camp after all? You know, it's a time to get back to work. We're antsy and itchy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So when is this over with? Mm-hmm. Rather than how here and now can we be church and build up God's reign?
I know.
Two very different questions. Yeah.
Yeah, but what if looking up to Christ in heaven, what if that's not avoidance of the task at hand? Like, what if in order to build up the reign of God, what if we need to look up to Christ in heaven? You know, what if that's necessary to make that mental and spiritual shift that we need to make to be infused with hope? And what if we need to look up to Christ in heaven to really, truly be fueled by Christ's love and his intercession for us? You know, I thought this was interesting because in some ways, we really are not so good with the ascension in the church, right? And I read something by Andrew Root and Kendra Greasy Dean, and they were talking about diagnosing the church with, get this, with an ascension deficit disorder.
Ascension deficit disorder. Yeah. Okay, now I'm a psychologist and I've heard of attention deficit disorder. I can't say I've ever heard of ascension deficit disorder. So I'd have to think about what those diagnostic criteria might be for ascension deficit disorder. And I'm guessing it might be a tendency to act as though the future God, as promised in Jesus Christ, is no more than pie in the sky vision. Would that be the symptom?
Well, when we suffer from ascension deficit disorder, we basically live in fear, right? We're not the first anxious people of God who are asking, are we there yet? Like, when is this happening, this kingdom of God? So ascension deficit disorder means that all we remember is Jesus the man who lived, loved, died, was resurrected, and was seen a few times and then left for good. But ascension is not goodbye. Ascension is a new beginning. And it's not a vision of abandonment. It's a vision that daily creates our hope for God's reign. And it's already happening. But it doesn't mean that we should be humanistic do-gooders. You know, it means that we are really, truly, in a spiritual, prayerful way, looking for Christ in heaven, and then are energized by the Holy Spirit to love God's world with his love. And as we build God's reign, the sky is the limit.
Okay, now wait a minute. You kind of lost me there. Think about the people of God. We all worry about the economic fallout from the coronavirus pandemic. People lose their jobs daily, lots of them.
No.
Parents are doing the best on Zoom and on the computer while they try to keep their three-year-old occupied or their kids educated. Elderly folks are suffering from isolation and wonder how they, if they can ever again hug their grandchildren. People who plan on retiring this year now cannot. And maybe even face greater pressures around work issues. Teenagers can't stand sitting at home alone anymore. And some people are actually starting to rebel openly against isolation. Graduations are happening on Zoom. Birthday parties are planned at a distance. Everyone's home for the summer. The dog now knows no boundaries at all. life seems chaotic, changes every day. It changes with our moods, and the crisis is barely being managed. This is a lot. The virus seems to stay with us. We don't have a vaccine or a cure. And in the midst of all that, we want to build up God's reign and love the mundane.
I know. Well, Christ ascended, and human dust sits at the right hand of the Father. So meanwhile, Christ loves us into co-creating God's world. And he's with us even more intimately. So because God loves me, even in this total chaos, and I know Christ loves every part of this creation and every human being, I can practice loving what, frankly, I often have trouble loving. So the idea is that we understand that through the Holy Spirit, we are capable of contributing to this world. And we're able to love as Christ loves. And we're empowered to forgive ourselves and others when we can't. And then, you know, maybe we can hold life like a face between our palms and sort of say to it, yeah, okay, I will take you. I will love you again. And yeah, despite the suffering that we see every day too. You know, in the service, in the liturgy, we usually say, lift up your hearts, because we need to pray to the heavens to find the strength to love life over and over again, even the mundane parts. And it's not heroic, you know? It's just mundane.
Yeah, it really isn't heroic. What you say makes me think of the novel The Plague by Albert Camus. And he describes how a doctor fights an uphill battle. He's trying to alleviate the suffering of the bubonic plague. And he insists he's not a hero. He says, I have the quote here, "This whole thing is not about heroism," he says. He says, it may seem a ridiculous idea, but the only way to fight the plague is with decency. And when he's asked what decency is, he says, in general, I can't say, but in my case, I know that decency consists in doing my job.
So what does our job as Christians consist of? That's what we have to ask ourselves, right? I mean, it seems to me that we must pray as the disciples did. I mean, that's where the text ends, right? Prayer alone and in community. And we must contemplate our lives and the life of our communities from the perspective of the risen and ascended Christ and from his love for this world. And then, you know, to open ourselves to the Spirit's power, to wait for that power to really be with us. And then we'll know what to do. And we will know how to meet Christ in the eyes of those that we meet every day. And then we can practice loving others and even loving what we deemed unlovable in ourselves and in others. And that kind of practice of loving can be rather mundane. And then we have to forgive ourselves for not being able to, only to practice it again. But we are competent, and through the Holy Spirit, we are actually powerful enough to make a difference.
You know, I was going to say, practically speaking, you know, it might mean calling elderly people that we know regularly. I'm thinking of the pandemic now, especially, to listen, engage them, nurture their hearts, feed their minds, become a pen pal of someone like a prisoner, start writing letters to lift people out of loneliness, share our stories, offer guidance to people, offer a sense of community to others.
Yeah, I like those ideas. Or, you know, sitting down and calculating how much of the stimulus check we might actually donate and give back to the community or to give for a cause that we've been passionate about for a while. It may be a great time to join a Zoom environmental group, you know, now that we appreciate the clearer air and the clearer skies so much more. Or, you know, it occurred to me also how we could ask around in our communities, who are the healthcare workers, who are the essential workers, the supermarket people, you know, and how can we support them in this time? I mean, it's amazing for what little money some of these people do their jobs. And we could really help restore some, yeah, just some hope in humanity and some goodness as well. In fact, I was thinking about this too, you know, that we're so hooked on negative news that sometimes it's a spiritual practice in and of itself to try and look for positive stories and be intentional about sharing those.
Yeah. You know, I think that when you lose Christ's perspective of love for the world, you can think about how you can practice Christ's love today, how you can practice it. You know, looking for Christ where you least expect Christ to be, engaging others in the church around the question of what it may mean to be church for others these days, especially since the church has no walls today, really, these days. You know, pray about what you're learning in this time. Write a journal, maybe, on what you discover about yourself and about your faith. These are things you could be doing.
Yeah. And, you know, just last week, I went on a walk and I saw a dad who had taken out his kids, you know, outdoors, and they were sitting, you know, right next to the path and were studying some plants and critters. It was really sweet. And I thought, what a wonderful idea, right? But then I was also thinking about the people who are more likely to be isolated, you know, people who struggle with mental wellness, people we know who struggle with anxiety or, you know, who are down or may become confused, or people who are suffering from trauma, like veterans, young women, sometimes children, workers who got injured on the job. You know, this is a time to to really truly reach out to those people. And those conversations aren't always easy, but I think they can be really, yeah, almost life-saving. They can be really a lifeline for people. And that's important, you know, reaching out. So I just think that we are called to keep replicating Christ's DNA and to you know, engender God's spirit of hope and love in our lives every day.
So are we the church of the sky? Mm. Or are we a church of the reign of God here and now, changing this world for the better?
Amen.
Thank you. Amen, and thank you.
Now, I invite you to join with voices from across the New England Synod in giving voice to the faith of our church. Together, let us confess our faith using the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God, not made. Of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us, after our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate.
For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius
Pilate. On the third day, he rose again and was buried.
In accordance with the scriptures. On the third day,
he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He ascended into heaven.
He will come again seated at the right hand of the Father
to judge the living and the dead. And his kingdom will have no end.
We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
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 Merciful Creator, your Holy Spirit intercedes for us even when we do not know how to pray. Help us as we commend to you ourselves, our loved ones, the church, the world, and all who are in need. Let us pray for all those who are sick or vulnerable to illness.
Almighty and eternal God, you give the gifts of life and healing. Pour out upon us these gifts. Bless those who are healers. Keep them healthy and give them stamina and encouragement. Amen.
Let us pray for people who have lost their jobs or are struggling financially.
Almighty and eternal God, time and again you have shown solidarity with the poorest among us. Show your care for all those who do not have enough, and make us to share in community and our society what we have so that no one else is without. Amen.
Let us pray for those who are lonely or separated from their communities or loved ones.
Almighty and eternal God, there is nowhere we can go that you are not present. Connect us and all who suffer separation. Especially give comfort to those who face dying alone, and to all who are mourning without being able to gather as love demands. Amen.
Let us pray for households confined together.
Almighty and eternal God, your nature is one of perfect, intimate relationship, but many of us, by being confined in close proximity with our households, are struggling. Remember those who are balancing demands of work and childcare, who have been forced together where relationships are strained, and especially those in danger of abuse, so that we may emerge from this time with health and wellness. Amen.
Let us pray for all those who suffer other afflictions.
Oh.
Almighty and eternal God, you see all and know all. We pray for all those who suffer from evils from which we are distracted, as we focus on the challenges which seem most pressing. We entrust to your care those who are not foremost in our thoughts right now. Send them helpers from among us, that they know they are not forgotten. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and its leaders.
Almighty and eternal God, through the church, you reveal yourself and call us to life with you. Lead us is responding to a world in crisis, proclaiming your love for all people and your word of salvation for all and from all. Amen.
Let us pray for those who serve in public office.
Almighty and eternal God, you appoint leaders from among us to be entrusted with responsibility for justice and the common good. But none of us possess your perfect righteousness. Give wisdom, trust, humility, and hope to our leaders for the sake of your children whom they serve. Amen.
Let us pray for God's whole creation.
Almighty and eternal God, you are the creator of a magnificent universe. Hold all the worlds in the arms of your care. Renew the vivacious beauty of our planet and all its living inhabitants. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Finally, let us pray for all those things for which our Lord would have us ask. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Almighty God, bless us, defend us from all evil, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Amen.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake, my soul, and sing of him who died for thee, and hail him as thy matchless king through all eternity. Crown him the Lord of love, behold his hands and side, rich wounds yet visible above in beauty glorified. No angel in the sky can can fully bear that sight. But downward bends his burning eye at mystery so bright. Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave and rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring and lives that day. Crown him the Lord of heaven, one with the Father known, and bless the Spirit through him given from yonder triune throne. All hail, Redeemer, hail, for thou hast died for me. Thy praise shall never, never fail throughout eternity. Thy praise shall never, never fail throughout eternity.
Thanks again for joining us today, and please allow me to leave you with this. May the Christ who walks on wounded feet walk with you on the road. May the Christ who serves with wounded hands stretch out your hands to serve. May the Christ who loves with a wounded heart open up your heart to love. May you see the face of Christ in everyone you meet, and may everyone you meet see the face of Christ in you. Amen. Now, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
A hymn of glory let us sing, new hymns throughout the world shall ring. Alleluia, alleluia. Christ by our rod before untrod ascends unto the throne of God.
Ages run with Father and with